We're so glad you joined us for this Easter, and we know that many of you are visiting with us, and God bless you for so doing. So what we're doing here is celebrating what this is all about. Really, this is what makes Christianity Christianity, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Without his subsequent resurrection after his death, we're just wasting our time here. You might as well have slept in. But I'm glad you didn't, because he is risen. There we go. For centuries and centuries ago, a tradition began. And really, tradition has it that the tradition began when a faithful group of Christians were being ready to be slaughtered for their faith in Jesus. And as they were about ready to be killed, they cried out with faith, "He is risen!" And in the hills were the believers who had not been caught, but they heard their faithful comrades cry out about the resurrection of Jesus, their hope even in death. And they cried out from behind those hills, "He is risen indeed." So, will you practice it with me? He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There you go. Now, I know that all of you don't believe that. And I don't say that humorously. I just know it's probably true. I don't mean that all, I mean, there are some of you probably that, you know, sort of believe it in your head, but you don't really believe it. And you'll see here in a few moments, there's a big difference between having the facts down and having the faith in Christ. And so I get it. So I want to take you on a little bit of a trip through Scripture here at the point of the resurrection and what took place at the resurrection. You're going to see from this passage of Scripture that I'm about to read that we're going to be called to do four things here today: to stand in awe, to come and see, to go and tell, and bow the knee. That's the way this passage works its way out. And if you would take your Bibles, if you brought one, and go to Matthew 28. If you didn't, don't worry about it, because the words you'll see will come up. So Matthew chapter 28, the first 10 verses, here's how it goes. "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid. I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He is risen.'" You can say amen. "As he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy. This admixture of fear, having seen what they just saw, and joy. "And ran to tell his disciples, and behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings,'" or literally, "rejoice. And they came up, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me.'" And therein lies the difference between every other religion and Christianity. Christianity declares emphatically and from the hilltops, "He is risen. Our Savior lives." What difference does that make in your life? For some of you, it hasn't made any difference. And for others, like Brad and Carrie, big difference. Amen? Big difference. Many years ago, I was talking, actually listening to a good friend of mine who actually mentored me. And he, just a great guy. And on this occasion, he was talking to a bunch of collegians. And he was talking about the Christian life. He laid out the gospel that Christ died and he rose again. And then he said this, I'll never forget it. He said, "And I want to tell all of you college students that even if none of this was true, that Christ died and rose again, the Christian life would be worth it." But that rang hollow to me, because I thought, no, No, it wouldn't. I understood what he meant. If you apply the characteristics of Christianity to your life and you're not a Christian, you can apply, it'd be hard, but you could do that. It'll probably help your marriage and your family out a little bit, and might please your boss because you won't steal from him. You won't be sleeping around with your neighbor and, your spouse won't be doing the same. That's a good thing. You won't get in jail probably because you're doing these things. You'll just be cleaned up to go to hell. And that's the way a lot of people are. They ascribe to the tenets of the faith. Let me tell you something. If my life for Jesus Christ does not lead to eternal life in heaven, it ain't worth it. I just read this morning in Psalm 49, where it says, the redemption, the atonement for their souls is costly. No amount is ever enough. You could never pay for the price of your soul. That a man should live and not see the pit. You can't buy your way into heaven, but you can believe your way there. And that's what the gospel is the death and resurrection of Jesus. That's what the gospel proclaims. You believe this with all of your heart, and your life will be changed, completely changed, because he is risen. And the Apostle Paul said, if Christ is not risen from the dead, then our preaching is vain, your faith is vain. This is just a bunch of empty foolishness here. But he says a couple of verses later, but indeed Christ is risen from the dead, and he has become the first fruits of those who believe. Now, this passage of Scripture, as I said, calls for us, and indeed gives us four invitations, okay? The first one is this: stand in awe. Stand in awe. I mean, just the mere reading of the passage, think about what he's saying here. I mean, think, the morning arrives, there's an earthquake, this massive stone is rolled over by an angel that appears from heaven, he sits on top of the stone. I don't know why he sat on the stone, but it's pretty cool to visualize it. And then all suddenly the soldiers are so caught up by this resplendent angels, they just sort of drop dead like, which I think is really funny. Because if you think about it, those guys assigned to assure Jesus stayed in the tomb became like those who belong in a tomb. Angels were always showing up at the most epic moments in Jesus' life. They were there when he was born. You know that this choir of angels appears before the shepherds, right? Glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. They're there. It's like they just can't wait to get out of heaven to worship the one who created them. And then throughout his life, when he was tempted, there was an angel to comfort him. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, praying with drops of blood beating up on his stressed body, there was an angel to comfort him. And when he would be subsequently arrested, and Peter tried to be the courageous one, takes out his knife, tries to take the head off of a guard. Remember that? Jesus, all he aimed for the head, got an ear. Jesus puts the ear back and then looks at Peter and says, put your sword away. Don't you know there's 72,000 angels that just can't wait to get into this thing? That's what he said. The angels, it's like the angel just dying to jump into the life of Christ. And then at his resurrection, here they are. Here they are. And so it shouldn't surprise you. And you notice how I emphasized it in the reading. Remember I said, behold, 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 behold. Four times in this passage it says, behold. I'll just remind you, verse 2. And behold, there is a great earthquake. Later on, behold, he's going to Galilee. And then again, and behold, Jesus met them and said, rejoice. Later on in verse 11, while they were going, behold, again, the same word. It's a strong word. It's the Greek word edu. It means look. It always implies an exclamation point. Always, this word does. Look, behold. God is inviting you to come here and just stand in awe and look at what's going on here. And this actually reminds me of my favorite passage of Scripture on the resurrection, and that's in John chapter 20. You don't need to go there, but let me just sort of summarize it for you. It's my favorite because John wrote his gospel 30 years after Matthew wrote his. So he supplements facts that we just don't know about. So John tells us when these women show up and say, the tomb is empty, we saw this angel, boom, Peter takes off running for the tomb. He's always impetuous. He doesn't wait for anybody. And John, the younger one, takes off with him. John's younger, Peter's older, he's a little heavy, and John's zoom, right by him and gets to the tomb first. And John 20 tells us that when John got there, it says he saw the open tomb. And it uses the word blepo, just the normal Greek word for to see, just to look, to see, just to glance. He sees it. Peter, he gets there, pushes John aside, looks in, and the Bible says he saw. But it uses a different word. It uses the word, we get our word to theorize, to theory, to think, to gaze. It means he's staring at this. He's contemplating this. And then John, pushing Peter aside, he goes in. And John, and the Bible uses another word for saw or to see. It's the word which means to see with understanding. Now, you might be thinking, man, I don't know Greek. You don't have to, because if you read John 20, it says, on that third time it says John saw, it says he saw, understood, and believed. Because that's the kind of sight that brings faith. That's the kind of sight that brings faith to a person outside of Jesus Christ. And by the way, that totally describes my life. There was a time in my life where I was just looking. I knew all about Christianity. I was raised in a church that taught that Jesus died and rose again. I could recite the Apostles' Creed like some of you can. But it wasn't a heart thing. It was just a head thing. Then somebody came to me and told me about Jesus personally, and that I personally needed to receive him. And I went from looking to gazing. It became something very alluring to me, which is exactly where some of you are at right now. It's alluring. You like it. You desire it. But it's not there because you haven't from your heart embraced Jesus. Because the sight that saves is the one that looks upon the gospel, embraces Jesus as the Lord, Savior, and King of your life, and your life is changed like it was for John's. So I invite you, as the text does, stand in awe. And then, of course, we are talking about the resurrection of Jesus. Come and see. Isn't that what the angel says? He says, come. In verse 6, see the place where he lay. Matthew doesn't spend a lot of time talking about the inside of the tomb like John and some of the others do. Matthew just wants you to know it's empty. He's not there. He is risen. Come and see. He invites you to take a look. The angel didn't roll back the stone, by the way, to let Jesus out. Let's make that clear, okay? He rolled back the stone to let you and me in. And to see with affirmation that his words were true, that he wasn't there. In fact, the angel sort of puts a little ribbon there. If you look in verse 6, it says, the angel replies, as he said, which is kind of a little rib there. He reminds him, he did tell you he was going to rise from the dead, right? Oh, that's right. So it's all there. And so when Jesus, if you down later on, the angels take off, they obey. The angels obey. The women obey the angel, and they take off, heading toward the disciples, and then here comes Jesus. The text says he sees them, and what does he say to them? Do they say, hi? The old King James says, all hail, which makes no sense to me, but that's not what the word means. The new King James gets it right. He said, rejoice. Which is kind of strange. Have you ever surprised somebody by saying, rejoice, it's me? That sounds kind of weird, doesn't it? The word could also be translated, cheer up. Again, imagine surprising somebody and say, cheer up, I'm here, party on. But this is how Jesus meets the women. He doesn't meet them by saying, greetings, like some of your Bibles say. He meets them by saying, rejoice. And what I get from when I read this, it's almost as if Jesus is so giddy with excitement, he can't wait to tell them. Because he's risen, he knows the difference that it's going to make in anybody who truly, truly believes in him. And by the way, I don't know if you noticed it in the reading, but did you notice when Jesus met them? He met them as they acted in faith to go tell his disciples. That's when Jesus met them. I tell you that because If you will believe this message and act upon it with true faith, you'll meet Jesus. You'll meet Jesus, and you'll be saved. So this text is beckoning us to stand in awe, to come and see, and then to go and tell. I mean, both the disciple, both the angel and Jesus said the same thing to these women. Go and tell. Go tell him. He's risen from the dead. The angel said, go tell his disciples. Now, this is interesting because if you look later on in the text, Jesus says, go tell my brothers, which is really interesting. Brothers? You mean those 11 guys? You know, Judas has already offed himself. He's dead. He's committed suicide. But there's 11 others. And where were they at the cross? They weren't there. They were hiding. They were cowering. They were afraid. Those are his brothers? Yes. Still his brothers. Still reaching out. Jesus is already starting to reconcile these individuals before they're reconciled. If you read Mark's gospel, there's an addition. Go tell the disciples. And by the way, tell Peter, which is really kind of cool because remember what Peter did, right? Denied Jesus three times. And so it's almost as if you got to have that little extra addendum of encouragement. Because when you fail, follower of Jesus, those of you who really are, Jesus doesn't fight fire with fire. He fights it with forgiveness and reconciliation. That's what he does, and he's really, really good at it. So he says, go and tell. And by the way, it probably doesn't hurt to remind you that these are women getting the commission. These aren't the disciples. They haven't even showed up yet. They're women. Why do I point that out? Because no group of people in the life of Jesus was more faithful to Jesus through thick and thin than the women. The women have always outclassed the men in church history. They've always, can I get a female amen? They've always outclassed the men. As one writer put it, they were the last at the cross and the first at the tomb. And it didn't go unnoticed. They would be the first to see Jesus. Who was the first one to see Jesus? Oh, just a woman who was filled with seven demons at one time. A woman of the street, Mary Magdalene. If you're forgiven much, you love much. And the results will be a blessing from God. And so these women are blessed. And they would be the first to evangelize those who would evangelize the world. Let me say that again. The women would be the first to evangelize those who would evangelize the world. And what does this say to me? It means that this is not just good news for everyone. It's good news for everyone to tell. Go and tell. Those of you who are true followers of Jesus Christ, you can't keep this to yourself. You got to go and tell. Stand in awe. Come and see. Go and tell, and bow the knee. So Jesus comes, and he says, rejoice or cheer up, I'm back. And what do? They fall at his feet, they embrace him, and they what? They worship him, proskuneo. It means to prostrate oneself before somebody else. That's what it means. It means literally to bow the knee. That's what it means. And that's what they did. And that's what you do. When you've stood in awe, you've come and seen, it affects your life, it changes your life, you want to tell someone else, and you bow your heart to Jesus. That's what it does. And some of you still need to do that. Some of you are a lot like Brad and Carrie. Outstanding testimonies, right? The very first time they ever came to church, I was there, I met them. In fact, Abe Miller, our administrative guy's dad, was there. He's an evangelist. He was visiting with us, and he saw them. He grabbed them. He talked with them. He shared a story with them. He prayed with them, and there it is. Somebody snapped a picture of it. Actually, that was me. I snapped it. It was such a cool scene. They weren't saved yet. They had arrived at the tomb. They saw. And they were just entering into that time when they were starting to gaze upon it, which got them into their Bible studies. And you've already heard for they saw with understanding and believe they were just changed. This can happen to you. This can happen to you. If you go beyond just sight and stop gazing, because some of you just know all the facts, but you're not saved. Your life has never been changed. I had somebody come up to me the other day and said, you know, you said your life isn't changed, that you're not saved. You've just described all of my siblings. And I knew this person's siblings, and I thought, I agree, they're not saved. No, they've all prayed prayers, but their lives aren't changed. They're trusting everything else but God, and that could be you. Now look, we're not here to condemn you. But if you're not saved, you're already condemned. I didn't do it. The Bible says, he who believes in the Son is not condemned, but he who does not believe is presently condemned. Why? Because he hasn't or she hasn't believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. That's why. Today, the text is inviting you to stand in awe, come and see, go and tell, and bow your knee. And we invite you to do that right now. Bow your knee to Jesus now, because you will bow before him later. The Bible makes it explicitly clear. Therefore, the writer of Philippians says, God has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name. Things in heaven, things on earth, and things under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is King, Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Will you pray with me? And as we pray, we'd just like you to just think now. Now listen, if you're one of those individuals who've been just kind of looking, but you also gazed, and now this is making sense, and you're like John, you want to see and believe, and that's your heart's desire right now. Now, you just express that to God. You can make that really clear. It's got to come from your heart. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, God raised him, God raised him, God raised him, God raised him, God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And so would you just say right now, those of you who would say, I'm there, that's me, I want this, would you acknowledge your sin? Would you acknowledge your hostility to God? Would you acknowledge your resistance to him? Some of you right here, you may have been raised in a Christian home, in a wonderful church, but it's never really made a difference in your life. There's no joy. There's no tenderness. There's no running to God like Brad talked about, instead of running away from him. It's just, you're still running. But in your heart, you'd say, I don't want to run any longer. I want to trust Jesus. Just do so. Tell him you believe in him today. You believe with all your heart that he died and rose again for you. And trust him as your Savior right now. And you will be saved. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.